In September of 1977, the Vladimir Lenin nuclear power plant, better known as the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, was opened with the completion of its first reactor. Located near the town of Pripyat in Ukraine in the Soviet Union and named after the town of Chernobyl, 10 miles away from the plant, it was planned to have a total of 6 reactors. The fourth reactor was completed in 1983, and it was this reactor that would result in the worst nuclear accident in history. 3 years after the fourth reactor began its operations, on April 26, 1986, at around 1:30 in the morning, a test being done in order to create safety procedures went out of control, leading to a rapid increase in power and heat, which then led to a rapid buildup of steam and pressure, and ultimately, an explosion that blew off the shield over the reactor and blew the roof of the building off. This ruptured the remaining pressure tubes, causing a second and even larger explosion 3 seconds after the first one. The fire that had started at Reactor 4 burned for 10 days, resulting in large amounts of radiation that was released directly into the atmosphere, hitting East and Central Europe hard, but especially the areas of Ukraine and Belarus. In the immediate aftermath of the explosion and cleanup, around 30 people were killed. But estimates of the total number of people killed by the radiation vary widely, from 4,000 people to up to 60,000. An exclusion zone was created around the destroyed nuclear power plant, now totaling around 1,000 square miles or 2,600 square kilometers. And in the end, around 350,000 people in the area surrounding the plant were permanently resettled. The story of Chernobyl is a very familiar one to us, one that gets talked about a lot in regards to both the morality of nuclear energy, but also the decline of the Soviet Union. The story of Chernobyl is a lot more than just the disaster itself, though. When the explosion first happened, Viktor Bryukhanov, the manager of Chernobyl, initially downplayed the damages at his plant. This was both because they didn't have the tools to accurately tell just how much radiation was being released, but also because he didn't want the situation to seem like it was out of control. Clearly, however, the situation was out of control. Premier Nikolai Ryzhkov and General Secretary Mikhail Gorbachev learned about the disaster later that same morning, and an emergency meeting with the Politburo was set up for Monday, April 28th. Information was hard to come by, and accurate information even harder. Because the plant was operated from Moscow, many of the authorities in Ukraine had little to no idea what was actually happening right in their own backyard. The danger was being played down in order to not create a panic, but it was having the exact opposite effect. A day after the explosion, and well before it was officially acknowledged by the Kremlin, the town of Pripyat began an evacuation of its citizens using hundreds of buses. They were told to only bring what was necessary, as it was expected that they would be able to return sometime soon. Unfortunately, that would not be the case. Back in the Kremlin, there were severe disagreements on how the situation should be dealt with. Gorbachev, who had only recently come into power as the General Secretary, had been pushing forward the idea of glasnost, a term that was used to describe a desire for increased transparency within the Soviet government. The difficulty was, early on, reports received by Gorbachev often had conflicting information. Alexander Yakovlev, the chief of the Central Committee's propaganda department, said the military went in at one point and gave one story. With the scientists, it was a totally different story. He also said that Gorbachev came to be very wary of what he was hearing. During the first few days, he understood that information was not accurate, and that many people lied to him. The fact is, the Soviet public and the international community knew something had happened at Chernobyl. 2 days after the explosion, radiation alarms were being set off in Swedish nuclear power plants as a result from the radiation released out of Chernobyl, and obviously those in the immediate areas around the plant were being evacuated. With so much fear, but so little information, speculation spread like wildfire, fueled in part by newspapers and magazines pushing for information from their foreign correspondents. Any little bit of info they could get, they would take. Luther Whittington of United Press International heard from a Ukrainian woman in Kiev that 2,000 people had been killed in the explosion. And by Tuesday, April 29th, the New York Post was running a headline that said, 2,000 die in Nukemare. Soviets appeal for help as N plant burns out of control. The Ukrainian Weekly, ran out of New Jersey, reported that as many as 15,000 may have been killed. A Dutch amateur radio enthusiast reported a conversation that claimed many hundreds of dead and wounded, and a US intelligence source was quoted as saying that 2 or 3,000 had been killed or injured. Back in Moscow, Gorbachev, as well as a few other reformer members of the Politburo, wanted to release information and details about the explosion, in line with the idea of Glasnost. The moderate and traditional members of the group disagreed, however, either wanting to give less information or barely any at all. In the end, Glasnost was defeated, as the upcoming May Day parade and celebration on May 1st came and went without any official statements from Gorbachev or the Kremlin. Despite this, Premier Ryzhkov and Second Secretary Yegor Ligachev flew out to the affected area. A prominent Soviet newspaper editor had this to say. Word about the visits of comrades Ligachev and Ryzhkov to the area of the power station had a positive effect. However, the silence of the Republic leadership in the ensuing days, in my opinion, again precipitated panic, especially when it became known that the children and families of leading officials are being evacuated. More than 1,000 people were lined up outside the cashier's windows of the Central Committee of the Ukrainian Communist Party. Naturally, in town, everyone knew. Finally, in early May, starting around May 6th, more information was released from the Kremlin, finally giving much-needed details on what had happened in Chernobyl, as Gorbachev and his allies overrode the censorship rules that had kept them from speaking freely before. Then, on May 14th, Gorbachev himself spoke on the disaster, speaking frankly and truthfully about the damage that had been caused, only seeking to justify Soviet reactions and not downplay the situation that was at hand. To this day, the containment of the Chernobyl power plant is an ongoing effort, as it will be for many years to come. Oftentimes, when Chernobyl is discussed, it is brought up how it may have helped cause the fall of the Soviet Union, or at least accelerate it. So, the question can be asked, what if the Chernobyl disaster never happened? While the disaster at Chernobyl may have had some effect on the decline of the USSR, it most certainly did not result in its collapse. Had Chernobyl not occurred, the USSR was still on its way out. The main factors that led to its collapse was the economic strain the country was under, the new political freedoms being granted, and the new information being let in from outside the Soviet Union. This might seem a little bit of an anticlimactic answer to the question of what if Chernobyl had never happened, but despite the fact that it was an incredibly large disaster, it was not that large on the scale of the entire Soviet Union. An individual disaster like this is unlikely to bring down the government of a country with 280 million people. However, while the Chernobyl disaster may not have led to the fall of the Soviet Union, it certainly is an interesting case study on why the Soviet Union fell, acting almost as a microcosm of the USSR's biggest faults, that being factionalism within leadership on how to react to situations, and the desire to hide the truth, either for self-preservation or for what they perceive as the greater good. Now, something that the Chernobyl disaster did do was sow massive distrust in nuclear power, particularly in Europe. Hundreds of proposed nuclear reactors were rejected worldwide, and many operating plants were closed after Chernobyl. The Italian people voted in a 1987 referendum to phase out nuclear power plants, a sentiment that has remained strong there and elsewhere in Europe to this day. Had Chernobyl not occurred, we might see more nuclear power plants, especially in Europe. Not to mention, there would not have been the catastrophic ecological damage done to the surroundings of the Ukrainian-Belarusian region. Something positive that did come from the Chernobyl disaster was an increased look into what causes these kinds of disasters. Chernobyl and the Challenger shuttle disaster, both having occurred in 1986, are similar in this sense. They, along with other catastrophes that occurred around the same time frame, cause agencies, both governmental and independent, to look into the root causes of these types of accidents and disasters. Out of these studies and this research, we do have a much better understanding on how to avoid similar situations in the future. So, while the damage done by Chernobyl to the environment and people around it can never be justified, we can at least hope that the engineers and leaders of the future learn from it, so that we may never see something as devastating again. Thank you very much for watching. Leave a like if you enjoyed my video, and subscribe to my channel with notifications turned on to see more of my content. Leave a comment with your thoughts on this video or topics for the future, and if you're interested, I've also made plenty of other videos, so go check those out too. This has been Historical Hindsight, and I'll be seeing you soon.